This week I'm going to start by telling you a little parable. One day a prince was riding over his lands and came to a clearing in a wood. In front of him he saw a tree, and in that tree, in the dead center of a roughly drawn bullseye, quivered an arrow. The prince rode on and found another tree and another arrow embedded with deadly accuracy in the center of a bullseye. Staggered by such amazing marksmanship, the prince thought the archer and said, "If you'll teach me to shoot as well as you, I'll give you half of my kingdom." "Certainly, Your Highness," said the peasant, and taking an arrow from his quiver, he shot it at a tree some distance away. Then, walking to the tree, he took a piece of chalk from his pocket and proceeded to draw a bullseye round the arrow. "There you are," said the peasant, "how to be a perfect shot in one lesson." Now, rather naturally, the prince felt he'd been taken for a bit of a ride, and being a man of honor, and incidentally feeling that properly applied there might be some future in the peasant's racket, he duly made over half of his kingdom. I'm glad to report that he never regretted it, since the formula of making sure of your aim by sticking the target onto the arrow instead of the arrow into the target proved in matters of state a very paying proposition. This week's casebook history is that of the master detective of all time, a sleuth with 120 captures to his credit. And I'm sure you'll see the connection between the little parable I've told you and the story of Jonathan Wilde. Jonathan Wilde, the detective who could give details of any crime before it was committed, and who only failed because he succeeded too well. But let's begin at the beginning, at something Mr. Wilde would never have done. Let me tell you the story of the perfect detective. Jonathan Wilde was born in 1682, and to understand the man and his work, you must picture the conditions of the time. At the end of the 17th century, London was overcrowded and chaotic. While its population increased by leaps and bounds, its city limits remained static. Beyond these limits, there was little or no attempt at administration. Little wonder that it was the criminal's paradise. To put an end to this state of affairs, the common law was injected with certain severe statutes which caused a great outcry from London's underworld and greatly increased the numbers of those residing in the prisons of Her Majesty Queen Anne.
"I'd just as soon be here in jail as out at the job. With these new laws, a man's hardly a chance to catch a living."
"It's just like a woman. She's not even got comfy on that throne of hers before she started mucking about with ways to confuse the poor suffering robbers at every turn. I tell you, it's just like a woman."
"It's the same for us blokes, you know."
"What you in for, Charlie?"
"Receive me. Caught with 2 bales of stolen silk just coming to the shop the night before."
"But that's no crime, surely."
"You know, where you come from, matey? Didn't you know our blessed Queen Annie's made it a capital crime to receive? She's made it so that if you steal something, you get hanged. And if you sells it to a bloke, he gets hanged."
"Oh, I'm telling you, she'll come to no end of a drop in the population if she carries on this way."
"But if the police hadn't found the silk in your shop, you'd have got away with it."
"Of course I would. But how quick do you expect me to get rid of the stuff? Can he come in the night before?"
"What if you never handled it?"
Don't be so daft. If he never handled it, he'd never receive it. If he never received it, he'd never sell it. If he'd never sell it, well, he might as well be some other trouble altogether."
"Let me explain. The only way the police can prove you're a receiver is if they catch you with the stuff in your hands. What if a thief told you where he'd hidden some stolen goods, so you could contact a likely buyer and direct him to the hiding place? The goods would never be in your possession."
"Sounds all right. But how do we split the money?"
"I haven't worked out all the details. But if you'd like to get in touch with me when you come out, I'll be found at the Cock Alley Tavern in Cripplegate."
"Why, that's Easy Mary's place."
"That's right. I'm collaborating with her for a time. I'm being released from here today."
"What have you been in for?"
"A few of my creditors became slightly too insistent."
"And you're now going to set up in business, receiving?"
"I'd rather call it obtaining. I shall obtain information about any theft. I shall obtain a buyer for the stolen goods. And I shall obtain a good share of the thief's earnings. I certainly advise you to come in with me, gentlemen. It will be enormously to your advantage."
"You talk very big."
"That's a maxim of mine, friend. Be your own trumpeter and don't be afraid of blowing loud."
"Here, what's your name?"
"My name is Wilde. Jonathan Wilde."
Short and lame, loud but insinuating, Jonathan Wilde was at this time 25 years of age. Soon after coming to London, he fell into heavy debt and consequently prison, where he served 4 years. On his release, Johnson joined his lady friend, Mary Milliner, in running the Cock Alley Tavern. It was a meeting place for criminals, and Wilde immediately set about his new business, obtaining, as he called it, right on the premises.
Sneaker! Sneaker! Come into the next room, will you? I want to speak to you. You'd be a fool if you didn't. It wouldn't be there when you came back.
There's a notice in the paper offering a reward for a diamond brooch. Stolen off Lady Borrowdale last week. I never heard of the theft. It wasn't reported to me.
No, sir. It wasn't one of my men.
Do you know the thief, then?
Yes, sir. He's out there now. Poor Jim.
And what's he done with the brooch? Call him, will you?
Okay, Jim. Hey, okay.
Come in.
Okay, something to do too well,
Mr. Wilde. All the better, Sneaker. All the better. Come in, friend. Come in.
See me?
Indeed, I do. Shut the door, will you, Sneaker? Now then, Porky Jim. First of all, realize I'm your friend. I'm here to help you. And if possible, make a little profit as well. Now, you stole a brooch from Lady Borrowdale last week.
Oh.
Never mind who told me, I know. Have you been able to dispose of it?
No. There's not so many receivers about, what with this new law.
Exactly. Now, how would you like me to arrange for its disposal?
You mean you'll buy it?
No, friend, no. I mean I'd find a buyer for you. How much do you want to get for it?
Oh, in the old days, a receiver would give me 15 guineas easy.
Then I suggest that anything over 15 guineas comes to me, right?
All right.
I'll be outside the Eagle Arms Tavern in Smithfield at 2 o'clock tomorrow. Then a lady will buy the brooch from you for a certain sum. I'll be expecting my share tomorrow evening. Here. If I don't get it, the police might be interested to know one or two facts. Goodbye for the present, friend.
The next morning at an early hour, Lady Borrowdale received a visitor. His charm of manner quickly broke down any bad impression caused by his unattractive appearance, and his information was received with delight.
Your ladyship, you must please forgive me for this early visit, but I have news which I'm sure will cause you great relief.
Pray continue, sir. Oh. May I first have your name?
So beautiful a lady may certainly have anything she wants of me. The name is Wilde, madam. Jonathan Wilde. My news is that you can recover your brooch for a price.
But I willingly pay.
How much, your ladyship?
Well, I could not go beyond 25 guineas.
Pity it is then, your ladyship, that the thief last night informed me he would part with the brooch for nothing less than £30.
Well, perhaps I could.
Outside the Eagle Arms Tavern in Smithfield at 2 this afternoon, a man will be waiting to sell your brooch to you for £30. I'm sure you will wish to avail yourself of the opportunity.
And what of you, Mr. Wilde? What payment do you require for this information?
Not a single farthing, your ladyship. I don't do these things for worldly interest, but for the benefit of any unlucky person who has met with misfortune. Your servant, madam.
Wilde's power quickly grew. The thieves of London, spurred on by the knowledge of a secure market for their loot, came to Cock Alley Tavern in ever-increasing numbers. And once they'd contacted Wilde, they were in his hands, for they knew that he'd have no qualms about turning them over to the law if they took one step out of line. But Wilde was not content. Too much business was still slipping through his fingers. He decided to have a chat with the city marshal, Mr. Charles Hitchens.
So you see, my dear Mr. Hitchens, my work of recovering stolen property is hindered by lack of knowledge, lack of information.
I understand, Mr. Wilde. You mean that not all the thieves of London tell you of their robberies? Dear, dear.
Oh, shall we say rather that not all the victims of these robberies employ my services?
And why have you come to me?
Well, perhaps we could work together, friend. The thefts I don't hear about are probably reported to you. If you then pass the information on to me, we might share the profits.
Mr. Wilde, I believe you trade to the authorities as a thief-taker.
Frankly, sir, a sideline.
A profitable one, though. Not only do you keep thus in with us, but you hold your thieves in fear and subjection. And, of course, there's the blood money you receive from the Crown for every capital conviction. Share that blood money with me, Mr. Wilde. I'll come in with you.
An excellent arrangement, Mr. Higgins. Agreed, then. By the way, I've opened an office for the transaction of my business. My henchman, Bruskin, runs it if I am otherwise engaged. The office is in the center of things, you might say, next door the courts in Old Bailey.
Rather near the law, Mr. Wilde.
To windward of it, sir. It's a maxim of mine that makes me keep in with them. Never do more mischief than is absolutely necessary for success.
Don't break the law. Bend it. Although the partnership between Hitchens and Wilde lasted only a year, both parties made a good profit from the deal. Wilde's dominion enlarged, but still he was not content. One morning he saw a way to get out of a difficulty and at the same time double his income. He'd always won for killing two birds with one stone. Recently he'd been having a good deal of trouble in disposing of stolen property.
I tell you, Mr. Wilde, I'm no pay a farthing more than £20 to get back something that's my own. Damn it, man, I can buy a new snuff box for less than that.
Well, I'm sorry, Mr. McCann. I cannot recover your own for less than 20. If you can buy another that's good for less money, do so.
Yeah, it's outrageous. What makes you think I'd pay so much?
Sentimental value, Mr. McCann.
Sentimental poppycock, sir. Good day here.
Now, one moment. That'll be 5 shillings, please, friend.
For what, may I ask?
For my time, friend. Thank you. Bruskin, show Mr. McCann out, please.
Yes, Mr. Martin.
I'll find my own way out, thank you.
Ah, well, Bruskin, that's the second person today who's refused to pay what I asked.
It's happening too much, Mr. Wilde, sir. Some of the lads are starting to grumble. Thanks to show we're giving them a market.
Ah, they needn't grumble any longer, Bruskin. We're going in for export. We have too many goods hanging around London waiting to be bought. We'll be charged as receivers before we know where we are. So whatever the original owners won't buy, I'm shipping to Holland. I've made Roger Johnston the skipper of a nice little vessel. And to make the journey worthwhile, he's going to bring back some other goods on the return trip.
What sort of goods, Mr. Wilde?
Something I know I can sell, Bruskin. Spirits. Yes, we'll dabble in smuggling. Purely as a sideline, of course.
Once his export-import venture was safely launched, Wilde, still unsatisfied with the financial results of his obtaining, embarked on another scheme. A scheme that is one of his chief titles to fame. He decided to organize the thieving profession. He made robbery a sound and profitable business. Profitable, of course, to himself. He was guided throughout by one of his maxims. Let self-interest be the one principle of action.
He's traveling on that coach. And she always carries our valuables with her.
Right you are, Mr. Wilde. We won't have no trouble. We'll choose a nice, lonely spot, make quite sure nobody's about, and then stand and deliver. Stand and deliver! Now then, ladies and gents, take the next few minutes nice and calm, and there won't be no need for violence. Take shot! Hold the horses and keep an eye on the coachman. Stark! Find the passengers.
Whoa there! Yeah, I can hold the beast, Gov, but I'd rather just stick an end with the ladies.
There ain't no time for pleasure, Bagshot. Now then, which of you ladies is Travers? Elizabeth, Lady Travers.
What do you want with me, Dylan?
Oh, nothing whatever, your ladyship. It's your travelling case I'm after. Hand over, if you please.
It would appear I had no choice.
That's right, your ladyship. That's what would appear. Thank you kindly. Now, my pal has finished with the other passenger. You can proceed on your way with no harm done, eh? All nice and friendly. Good night, all, and thanks for your cooperation. All right, come on, you two. We'll have a watch on it in a minute.
During the following months, the money poured into Wilde's office. Having arranged a robbery, he would sit back and wait for the victim to come to him. He was widely known by now, and pay for recovery. His smuggling from Holland was thriving, and his thief-taking, as it was called, was earning him a good income from the police in blood money. But the authorities were not totally blind to what was going on, and on a July morning in 1718, Wilde was visited by the chief officer of the watch.
Your activities as thief-taker are more closely connected than as lawful.
Oh, dear me, officer. Are our people once more slandering me?
Is it slander, Wilde? How is it that you are so successful in apprehending criminals? Phenomenally successful. How is it that...
But do I not...
How is it that you are always able to recover stolen property when...
Let me finish, friend.
But do I not the greatest good when I persuade these wicked people who have deprived folk of their properties to restore them again for a reasonable consideration? And are not the villains whom I have so industriously brought to suffer that punishment which the law, for the sake of its honest citizens, think fit to inflict upon them? In this way, I say, does not their death show how much use I am to the country? Why, then, should people asperse me or endeavor to take away my bread?
Not bad, Wilde. Quite eloquent. We don't want to deprive you of your bread, as long as it is earned apparently honestly. But your methods have caused too much comment. An act of Parliament is being passed this year which will hit most of your business on the head. Your obtaining business, as I think you call it. In future, persons who take rewards for recovering stolen property and actually recover it without apprehending the thief will be guilty of the same felony as the thief.
Well, that means a hanging, then, friend.
Yes, Wilde. Yours, if you don't reform. I just thought I'd warn you. Good day.
Good day, friend. Oh, a moment, officer. Have you by some blunder taken a colleague of mine into your jails in the last 3 days? His name is Joseph Blake, and known as Blueskin.
I'd know if we had. I've been longing to get him. No, he's not with us. Yet.
Thank you, officer. Good day.
In actual fact, Blueskin had left his employer. Too many of Wilde's colleagues had been turned over to the police of late, and Blueskin feared that his turn was coming. Wilde had no inkling of this when he rapped on Blueskin's front door that night, nor had Blueskin ever told him that he had a very charming wife.
Mr. Joseph Blake at home?
Go on, say Blueskin. We all call him that. He's out at present.
Oh, you're his daughter?
Wife? You have a subtle way of flattery, Mr.
My name's Wilde. Jonathan Wilde.
Jonathan Wilde? My dear, won't you come in?
With the greatest of pleasure, ma'am.
You speak so cleverly. So unlike Blueskin.
Oh, by the way, where is the fellow?
Isn't that the job he's done for you?
I've not seen him these last 3 days. What job, pray?
In silver at the Spanish ambassador's mansion, I think he said.
Keith, has he taken upon it himself, too? Am I to be betrayed by my closest henchman? Your
pardon, Judith. We were speaking of more important things.
Yes, Jonathan?
Was it not a pennyweight of love I mentioned?
First thing next morning, Wilde was hard at work securing the arrest and imprisonment of Blueskin. Not only the knowledge of his helper's treachery urged him on, but also the seductive charms of his wife. Another opportunity to kill two birds with one stone. In an evil-smelling cell at the Old Bailey, Blueskin desperately sought means of escaping the gallows. Wilde, who at this time was levying safety money from most of the criminals in London, was adamant.
But, Mr. Wilde, sir, please be easy on me. You're so powerful. What good can my death do you? You could easily bribe some of these fellows and get me a pardon, conditional on transportation. I'd stay away, sir. I'd never come back, honest.
I took your penniless from the gutter, Blueskin. I taught you the trade. I gave you good reward for your services. Think of your wife, Blueskin. Could you have married her without the security and salary I put in your way?
No, sir. I'm very grateful.
Not grateful enough, friend. By breaking away from me, you're showing gratitude. Furthermore, you made yourself my enemy. And it's a maxim of mine, Blueskin, never to forgive an enemy. I'm afraid it is inevitable that you will hang. But I promise you the best coffin that money can buy. The money I receive for your capture.
Oh, don't be so heartless, Mr. Wilde. Have pity on me.
I pity any man who is 9/10 of the way to the gallows, Blueskin. I suggest you prepare to meet your death with calm and repentance. I shall send you some books tomorrow to ease your final hour.
You swine. You're drinking over it. I'll see you to your death. I'll show you.
Take your hands off this clown. I'll show him. He's told him that. He's in trouble. Water!
To celebrate the hanging, Wilde presented Judith, the dead man's wife, with a ruby ring, one which he was to wear for many a day and night to come. In the years that followed, Wilde's power and fortune doubled and redoubled. As a new Act of Parliament was enforced, he gradually abandoned his business of obtaining. His main occupation now was thief-taking, and many hours were spent arranging new robberies to increase his stock of thieves for the gallows. The loathing Wilde had inspired in the underworld was increased tenfold. It was indeed to prove the main factor in his undoing. But what actually put him into Newgate Prison was surely the most uncharacteristic gesture of his career. He helped a friend. It was early in 1725 that Todd Snap, Wilde's current right-hand man, burst into his employer's office with alarming news.
What in glory is the matter, Snap? You look troubled.
Johnson's been took.
And what am I meant to gather from Johnson's been took?
Roger Johnson, Governor, the skipper of our smuggler. He's been took. He's in Wood Street, come to jail at this minute.
Dear me, yes, it is serious. But I fear there's nothing we can do about it, Snap. The blood money will go to someone else, that's all.
Governor, you've got to get him out. I don't know how, but you've got to. If you let Johnson down, there won't be one man left on your side. They'll think you put him in for one thing. Everyone knows you've been carrying on your business with Owen for ages.
That'll do, Snap. All right. We shall make an effort on Johnson's behalf. I want you to go and round up as many ruffians as you can find. Get them to meet in Cockle Street. That's just near the jail. At 7 o'clock tonight. Offer them a shilling apiece to make the most unholy row ever heard in London. I shall visit Johnson now and tell him to be prepared to escape when the riot commences.
The plan was successful. Johnson escaped. But the news leaked out that Wilde had organized the jailbreak, and as soon as he reappeared in public, the master criminal was thrown into Newgate Prison.
Jonathan Wilde, you're under arrest for procuring the escape of a person, Roger Johnson, accused of a felony smuggling. Order in the court. Jonathan Wilde, since your arrest on the 15th day of February on the charge of procuring the escape of a felon, a further charge has been laid against you that you organize a gang of felons, highwaymen, burglars, shopbreakers, pickpockets, and assisted them in disposing of their booty. Your trial is held over until the 15th day of May.
Not so good, Snap. Too many men against me. Mostly dead.
You mean the ones you captured, Mr. Wilde?
Yes. This is the revenge of their friends. I'll put it all in this pamphlet. I want you to distribute it to every person in court tomorrow. The jury especially. Wait. Hear how it sounds. Members of the jury and bystanders, you see before you a man ill-used by fate. I, Jonathan Wilde, the scourge of the criminal world, am now brought to court by the machinations of criminals. No less than 120 rogues have I turned over to justice. In the course of my duties, I have been involved in fights and violence of the severest order. Any man who does good must also have enemies. It is my enemies who have brought me here. I trust that you, my friends, will secure my liberty. Yes. I wonder what the 12 good men will say when they read that.
You, my friends, will secure my liberty. Oh, no, you won't. Still, I admire the devil. Came to the last. Look at him over there. Sneering, if you please.
So ugly, ain't he? And they say he's a gay dog when it comes to the women. Oh, well, there's no accounting for their taste.
It'll give me rare pleasure to cast my vote against Mr. Jonathan Wilde, and I shall be at Tyburn to watch him hang,
along with 2,000 or 3,000 others. I'll see you there, Jim.
Hey, Jim. I told you I'd be here. What a clown, eh? That's old Stinger does his work well. There's something happening. Oh, wow, I was going to speak. Friends,
keep hatred concealed in your heart, but wear the face of a friend. That was another maxim of Jonathan Wilde, a man of tireless energy, breathtaking nerve, infinite resource. What a statesman he might have made. what heights his career might have reached had it not been cut short on that lovely spring morning in 1725 when, not altogether to his surprise, he was executed. Pity, I should like to have met him. Yes, as I said at the beginning of this broadcast, the peasant who drew the bullseye round the arrow had nothing on Jonathan Wilde, who told the thief where to rob and the police where to catch him. Jonathan Wilde's story suggests, I fear, that to be a perfect detective, you have to be a crook. Fortunately, I've never heard anyone from Scotland Yard claiming perfection. Well, that's all for now, but I'll be back again soon to tell you some more of the secrets of Scotland Yard. Meanwhile, this is Clive Brook saying goodbye and pleasant dreams. Thank you.